Recently, I have been looking into energy poverty analysis and how to identify hidden forms of energy poverty. So what we have done is collaborated with a utility company in Arizona to identify the times and temperatures at which low-income households would start to use their air conditioning units in the summer. And one reason that this is important is because we are nervous about low-income customers limiting their energy usage in order to reduce their financial strain. So what we've done is we've plotted the times at which high-income groups turn on their AC units as well as low-income groups turning on their AC units. And what we've found is that low-income groups wait 5 to 8 degrees longer than high-income groups to actually just start using their air conditioning units. And so that is a form of hidden energy poverty that we have been quantifying. And we think that that's really important for energy justice efforts to alleviate energy poverty, because as we're planning our energy systems, we need to figure out how much energy do people need to use, when do they want to use it, and when do they feel like they're not able to use it. If you spend more than 6% of your income covering your energy bills, then you would be defined as energy poor. But this doesn't take into account whether or not people are foregoing their energy consumption. And that 6% really assumes that everyone is using all the energy that they actually want to. And so our work that quantifies the energy limiting behavior of low-income households is actually adding to our energy poverty identification, because now we can see who foregoes energy usage in order to reduce financial strain. One of the biggest impacts of this work is to identify who may actually want to make themselves more comfortable or safer in their home, who's at risk of heat-related illness or even heat-related death. Because if you're in your home and you're not using your air conditioning unit when it's 80 degrees outside, you are at risk of heat stroke or heat-related illness. And that's something that we need to be able to identify and address moving forward. So we have a really strong collaboration with a utility company in Arizona, and we have been working with a utility company in the Mid-Atlantic region. And we have been working with them to try to broaden their view of who should qualify for energy poverty alleviation programs, such as the Weatherization Energy Assistance Program, which would provide households with money to improve their windows, maybe add in insulation. We've also been working on some collaborations with people invested in pushing forward the Justice 40 initiative that the Biden administration has been promoting. And the Justice 40 initiative aims to promote that 40% of the benefits from investments in climate change efforts should go to disadvantaged communities. And one way to do that is actually to broaden the definition of who is defined as energy poor and who actually needs to get some of that assistance. What I would ask people to take away from this is that we need to have more inclusive and broad definitions of poverty and who's experiencing poverty, because there is a risk of missing some of these hidden forms of energy poverty. If someone is in their home and they're not using their air conditioning unit when it's 80 degrees or more outside, then they are having a serious health risk. And that's something that we need to try to get to in advance of them actually experiencing a heat stroke or a heat-related illness. And I think that data really presents an opportunity to address some of these poverty needs of different communities.